the inside.
Unbelievable.
Up the inside, or what? Absolutely incredible. Out goes the light, off we go. A lot of clutch slip, of course, on these little two strokes. It takes a lot of effort to get a 1-2-5 up the hill towards Paddock Hill Bend for the first time. Hopefully they all get through safely.
Dan Linfoot got a flyer off the line there, Keith, with Alex Lowe's bringing him up for a double Vision Racing. The number 22, the all-white bike there in second, the comfortable second for him at the moment. He was moved up the grid because he set exactly the same time as James Ford, but he set it earlier on in the session, so he was moved up the grid onto the front row. He's certainly making that pay now. He's already chasing down Dan Linfoot.
I'm glad you clarified that for me, because I tie myself up in a knot. That'll teach me to read the paperwork in front of me instead of look at the grid out of the window. So for Dan Linfoot, looking particularly sharp as he goes up to McLaren for the first time. The rest are in a bit of a melee of 1-2-5s. Through 17, Clark.
Sorry, Keith. 17, Robbie Stewart already being dubbed up there by Ford. Just behind him, Robbie Stewart, wee Midgey to his family out there. He's been christened after this race. Don't really know the reason why. I know he's got it splattered all over his bike, though.
I'm sure he'll let you know next time you track him down around here. You've been doing enough legwork trying to check up on the 125s in the paddock. Well, they're not appalling conditions, but they're not great conditions, that's for sure. You can see even our camera up on the roof of our grandstand here where we are in the commentary position. Now, that's a really tricky part of the course, because the cars, when they race here, dig their skirts into the ground and make that part of Paddock Hill Bend very slippery as it drops down and then rise up Halewood Hill towards Druids Corner. Now they're down towards Graham Hill Bend. Another difficult part of the track. They're on the left-hand side of the tyre here. They've not quite got enough warmth in it. It really does feel very strange as they turn left for the first time in the last, what, three or four times.
Alex Lowes is really chasing down Dan Linfoot. He's talking about getting the bit between your teeth, but it is James Ford is just managing to hold off right now from wee Midgey. And, well, it looks like Stewart's coming through as well, but just got blocked off there as they were coming up to clearways. Tricky to get the power down on these bikes, and a lot of these bikes have a new kit for this year, which is more power valve based. But there are a few riders out there who've opted to go for the older kit, citing that as delivering more power.
There you go, you see, well, if you knew something about it, Tony, then you'd know why, because the power valve, of course, gives you more mid-range, whereas the old kit bikes gives you more probably top-end range. So depends whereabouts you are. The power valve kit in these kind of conditions might work a little better for these little 125s. Two-stroke technology, something that's a dying art, effectively. 17 looking for the inside down into... Oh, that's a brave move if you can do it. You could have a major wipeout or a brilliant move. It's that close. But two-stroke technology now slowly but surely being phased out. Of course, MotoGP, the top class, has now gone four-stroke. World Superbikes, of course, is four-stroke based on street bikes. World Super Sports, likewise. The 125 Grand Prix. I cite this class as being the best training ground to move through to MotoGP. I know that some people think that the Virgin Mobile Cup is, and some of the four-strokes similar are, but the 125s, I think it gives these youngsters a real opportunity to work out racecraft and also about how to set a motorcycle up, a racing motorcycle up, on a racetrack.
Daniel Cooper, Daniel Ferret Cooper, the 18-year-old from Stroud, just muscling his way past there and tipped by many in the 125 paddock has been one of the major guys to get out there and watch this year.
I love it when you've been doing some homework. Ferret it is, muscling his way by. I've never seen a muscly ferret in my entire life, but
keep,
I suppose,
Daniel Cooper,
there is an analogy somewhere in 125 racing, I believe. Lap 4 of 24, a very wet 24 laps. It's still raining, it's still windy, it's still miserable, and the terraces, I have to say, well, motorcycle race fans are a very loyal bunch, and they've stayed at trackside in conditions I think I'd have been running for a hot cup of tea. Linfoot looking for a way round the outside, this time drops it across the nose of 36, who was David Barfoot.
Oh, he's just touched the white line there, Linfoot did.
He's just having a go any which way, because he knows that you can't really allow these guys to hold him up too much. But then again, I mean, his lead is only 1.7 seconds, and you can soon eat all that up trying to carve your way through back markers. You've got to be fairly ruthless. And also, with a 125, it's about corner speed, it's about flow. You can't shut the throttle on these things, because once you shut the throttle, you've got no horsepower to get your momentum back up. So you really have got to keep the thing going, got to find the momentum, make it flow. It's a bit like slalom skiing in these kind of conditions. You've got to find the edge and keep on it, turn, and make it work for you. If you shut the throttle and then try and drive your way by, it's an impossible situation. It's all about corner speed. 125's got to keep it going. I think that's why it's a great training ground from that point of view as well. Strategy, tactics, corner speed. Whoops, that's a motorcycle that
that's Nathan Pallett,
has
think.
Exited stage left.
Oh, no, perhaps not. No, number 37.
That 37 is Hinton. Luke Hinton has gone down on the Build Base Honda. So Build Base are quite big sponsors in motorcycle sport, and we appreciate them very much indeed.
Well, you know, Dan Linfoot was saying that he really wanted to get back out to the Spanish Championship this year and do a few more rounds out there.
Well, I can think of a few other people that will be quite glad to see him go.
Well, I was just going to say that, if you know, based on this form, they do need help, though. They're like a lot of young teams coming through. And
I think the 125s get the short end of the stick every single time, or the sticky end of the stick, I should say. I mean, they really don't have any money, these guys. Carl Thomas Andrews just being passed there on bike 68. Remember Leon Camier when he rode in the 125s? Casey Stoner started here, and Casey Stoner, oh, that looks painful. He's winded, definitely. Hand in the air. 14 is down. That is Jack Groves. So Jack Groves on the Kingswood Motorsport Honda has exited stage left. And you can tell how wet it is just by how grubby he is. He's got a full-time job. I think they've got the stretcher out for depression. That's just to use an old, that's not one of mine. That's Julian Ryder, my good friend, who, of course, commentates all the time on MotoGP. So this 125 close class, very close to his heart as well. Lap 18 of 24. Still Linfoot leading by 1.7 seconds still. So he's consistently in front of 22. Alex Lowes on the Double Vision Racing Honda.
Although Lowes has just pulled back over the past couple of laps, he's pulled back about 3 or 4 tenths of a second. He got held up himself behind some back markers. Yeah. So he can close up a little bit, but...
Well, of course, the other thing is, I mean, he's got to keep trying. He can't let this guy just run away, because if he has a grass-tracking excursion, there's an opportunity still to pinch the win, and there's loads of time for that still. We're on lap 19 to 24. Linfoot, Lowes, Cooper, top three. They'll be on the podium if Rogers, Ford and Lowes, the other Lowes, has nothing to do with it. Clearways.
These Double Vision lads, they really are... A quality sort of outfit when you go and talk to them. They were, of course, the first twins ever to finish on a podium, and that was in the Super Teams a couple of years ago. And they've just got all the class about them, you know. And when you talk to them, they're very mature, which is really worrying for me, because, you know, when I was sort of fifth, well, I've got shoes that are older than these pair. I really have, you know, 15 years old, but they're so switched on, so sharp at what they're doing.
You've got shoes older than their fathers. 1.3 seconds now is Linfoot's lead, Everlow. So this young man is closing in on the race leader. We're on lap 20 of 24. That's not very far. 1.2 miles around this racetrack every lap. But he ain't giving up, that's for sure. We might have a bit of a grandstand finish right at the end of this race after all. In fact, I think we will.
Alex Lowes there on the white bike, number 22. He is looking good though, isn't he? Very composed. Very smooth.
Yeah, he is very smooth. But then again, I think that is the type of machine, the type of tyres, the type of setup. Sure. You know, they keep their corner speed, they keep their line. There's none of that mucking about offline and bouncing off of this one and bouncing off of that one. The 125, it's a very strict discipline.
Which is why it's such a good breeding ground for talent.
I think so.
If you can make a 125 go around a track fast, you've got the inherent bike skills that you will need in other classes.
Well, you'll need in other classes if you're going to go 125 racing in the GPs or 250 racing in the GPs, but they are arguably classes of the past. MotoGP and the four stroke classes, different type of style, I think, completely, that you need for that. And of course, super bikes or super sports world championships. So the 125s, they may be a dying breed. I mean, I really enjoy them. And it's a huge entry list here as well, so it's obviously an affordable Grand Prix class that these guys can enter into. 44 getting blown off, Philip Wakefield, Brookhouse Garage. No disgrace whatsoever, the conditions are so bad. You can't blame half these guys for taking it a little bit easy.
Well, Linfoot got the hurry up call there, just putting the fastest lap on lap 21.
So. Lowes just put
one back in.
I was going to say on lap 22, so the response has come immediately. And I think they're really, really getting on it. 22 or 24 we're on, and not a long way to go at the moment. Here's the battle for third, fourth. In fact, this is the fourth, fifth battle, isn't it? Rogers and Ford.
Yeah, Ferret's away in third.
And then the other, yeah, and then the other Lowes brother on the 11 bike. So both brothers having very, very good rides indeed. He's even more aggressive than his second place brother, isn't he? Sam Lowes then fighting with that machine. Linfoot leads by 1.4 seconds last time out. It's down to 8/10 of a second now. Linfoot's lead has been cut substantially on that last lap. So your race leader, Dan Linfoot, the fastest lap of the race, has just gone again to Lowes as he comes. Keep an eye on this man, Dan Linfoot. He leads, but he's under a lot of pressure now. He's got to hold his head together, because there is the competition. That is not a big lead. We're and on lap 23 or 24, so just a lap and a half.
And they've got more back markers coming up at the crucial point where you don't really want back markers all through clearways and clerks. If they're going to be on top of them, no, it looks like they'll be out of the way.
Well,
is that
they
Michael
might,
Hill?
They might get him at Paddock Hill Bend, so yeah. He looks like he's bright leathers. So fourth, Dan Linfoot. I'll tell you what, it'd be a travesty, wouldn't it, if he gets it pinched in this last lap.
Not if your name's Lowes.
Final lap now. Yeah, not if your name's Lowes. Well, that's quite neat round the outside. Wow, he dropped that right across his nose as well. So, I'm impressed with that. Michael Hill getting a style show there. I'll tell you what, he hasn't held up young Lowes in second place, though. We are, I remind you, on the last lap, and there is first and second after 24 laps almost. These two have been stuck together. One man that may just hold the key could look be number 76. That's Dean Hipwell.
But look at all the traffic here, Keith. We could have a real upset coming into the last couple of corners.
Oh, and there is the upset about to come at clearways.
Linfoot really got balked, but he's got through them.
He's got through at clearways. Checkered flag is being made ready. Blue flag waved frantically. It will make no difference. Over the line goes Dan Linfoot. That's a fine win for him. Second place in the end by 1.2 seconds. Caught among the back markers was young Lowes on the 22 bike. Cooper will finish in third. That'll be your podium. So the results then of the 125 race. Dan Linfoot, a fine win for him. He did it all on his own out front from Alex Lowes, who tried as hard as he could. In the end, balked by back markers. I don't think it would have made that much difference to Dan Linfoot, though. Daniel Cooper in third place. We'll see them on the podium in a moment. Anthony Rogers, James Ford, Sam Lowes, Robbie Stewart and Tom Haywood are the top eight. Ashley Beach in ninth place. Scott Rogers, Michael Wilcox, Brian Clark, Michael Smith, Dean Hipwell and James Maguire are our point scorers.